Well, good afternoon and welcome to all of you, especially those of you who are joining us from home, as it's our privilege to host here in St James's Church this very special service on the 80th anniversary of the Battle of Britain. And it's good to have a number of members of the Royal Air Forces Association with us who'll be leading the service.
Our chairman, Mike Sale, will now introduce the service, followed by a prayer.
Good afternoon, everybody. As chairman of the Trowbridge and West Wiltshire branch of the Royal Air Forces Association, it's my privilege to welcome you to this service on the 80th anniversary of the Battle of Britain. Between June and September 1940, the pilots flying Spitfires and Hurricanes repelled the attacks of vastly superior numbers of the German Luftwaffe and so prevented a planned invasion across the English Channel by Hitler and his hordes. The turning point was on the 15th of September 1940, which has been recognised as the Battle of Britain ever since. And my colleague Phil Kerrison will go into a lot more detail on this in his report. As Winston Churchill famously said in a speech at the time, never in the field of human conflict has so much been owed by so many to so few. 80 years on, it's important to honour the few, but also to remember all the many aircraft servicing technicians, armourers and other staffs on the RAF stations that were there to support the flying, and many lost their lives in doing so. By kind arrangement with the vicar, the Reverend Rob Thomas, and his technical experts, this service was recorded some weeks ago and is being transmitted by internet means today on Sunday, the 20th of September. This is traditionally the Battle of Britain Sunday, being the first Sunday after the 15th, and the date on which we would have had an actual service. But because of social distancing requirements applying in the church, it would not have been feasible to have a Battle of Britain service in reality. Contributing to this recorded service were several of my colleagues from the Trowbridge and West Wiltshire branch of the RAF Association and our president, who will read the lesson. Some of my colleagues also will announce in turn each item. So let us pray for the Royal Air Force on this 80th anniversary of the Battle of Britain. God of earth and sea and sky, to whom all creation owes its being, and in whose service their work takes wing, pour down upon the Royal Air Force in this year of thanksgiving the riches of your grace, that striving tirelessly for peace and justice, they may serve with faithfulness and courage through the Spirit of Christ our Lord. Amen.
We now have a report of fighter command operations for the 15th of September 1940. This will be read by Phil Kerrison, our branch welfare officer.
September the 15th fell on a Sunday in 1940. The German High Command had planned to issue new orders for Operation Sea Lion on September the 17th. Therefore, control of the skies was vital if the plan was to proceed and the invading barges were to be safe from attacks by the Royal Air Force. On September the 14th, the commander of the Luftwaffe, Hermann Göring, had sent out instructions that an all-out aerial assault was to be made on southern England on September the 15th. British intelligence, using radio message intercepts, had already informed Sir Keith Park that a large attack by the Luftwaffe was to be expected, but he was given no date, just that it would be soon. Park's 11 Group was expected to confront the bulk of the attack, and Park, as 11 Group's commanding officer, had done what he could to make it as effective as was possible given the rates of attrition it had suffered since the start of the battle. On the morning of September the 15th, Park was informed of a large build-up of Luftwaffe forces along the French coast. Park concluded that this was the start of the forewarned huge raid. while clear skies with just a minimal chance of cloud and rain denied the Luftwaffe clouds to disguise their approach, this bonus for the pilots of Fighter Command also meant that the Luftwaffe could clearly see incoming attacks by RAF fighters. Ironically, September 15th was the day that Winston Churchill chose to visit Fighter Command's 11 Group headquarters in Uxbridge. In his bomb-proof command centre 50 feet underground, Park ordered that Biggin Hill, Hornchurch and Kenley were to be put on standby to meet the threat posed by a Luftwaffe force gathering over Dieppe and Calais. Upon learning that the size of the incoming force was far greater than expected, Park ordered all of 11 Group to be at standby. At 09:30, two large Luftwaffe forces approached the southeast coast, but then turned back to France. This was possibly a feint attack, designed to see how Fighter Command might respond to such a force. Park ordered 11 Group to stand down. At 10:30, a very large Luftwaffe force was detected gathering between Calais and Boulogne. The sheer size of the force and the time to assemble it meant that the escorting ME-109 fighters were consuming fuel they could ill afford. This gave Park valuable preparation time, and 11 Group was again ordered to stand by. By 11 o'clock, it was clear from radar that a considerable bomber force was approaching with an unknown number of fighter escorts, estimated to cross the coastline at Dungeness at 11:45. Between 11:05 and 11:20, 12 fighter squadrons were scrambled, 4 Spitfire and 8 Hurricane. They faced a huge Luftwaffe force that was 2 miles across and flying between 15,000 and 26,000 feet. Flying among the bombers were ME-110 aircraft, while flying above the whole force were covering ME-109s. The size of the incoming force prompted Park to order part of Group 12 Group to scramble. Between 11:35 and 11:40, a further 11 squadrons took to the air, 4 Spitfire and 7 Hurricane. Thus, Fighter Command had 23 squadrons in the air. As the Luftwaffe force crossed Kent, 11 Fighter Command squadrons intercepted it. A further 12 were kept in reserve or used to protect London from incoming bombers. The intensity of Fighter Command's attack led to one Luftwaffe pilot later writing that we thought that the whole of the RAF was there. The nearer the Luftwaffe bombers got to London, the more Fighter Command squadrons joined in. Many of the ME-109 escorts, low on fuel, had turned back. This left the bomber force easy prey to the Spitfires and Hurricanes that seemed to surround them. Park's holding squadrons in reserve to protect London was a vital tactical move, causing Luftwaffe bombers to drop their bombs early and randomly to lighten their load, thereby facilitating a speedier return to occupied France and Belgium. Fighter Command had fought over a substantial area of sky, 80 miles long and 38 miles wide. However, the day was not over for Fighter Command. Having fought the first of two huge waves of enemy aircraft, while the first wave returned to France in disarray, the ground crew of Fighter Command rearmed and refueled their aircraft in readiness for another attack. At 13:30, radar picked up another large Luftwaffe force massing off Calais, 150 bombers escorted by 400 fighters. They were expected to cross the English coastline at 14:15. The ground crews had ensured that every squadron that had fought in the morning attack was ready by 14:00. By 14:05, 20 squadrons were in the air. It was clear that the Luftwaffe's target was again London. The incoming raiders were spread across a 10-mile front. The fighting was as fierce as in the morning attack. Those bombers that had managed to get across Kent and Surrey were faced with 15 squadrons that had been tasked with protecting London. Once again, German bombers dropped their bombs at random and short of the intended target, the docks in the East End, which received just minimal damage. The incoming Luftwaffe formation had been attacked with such ferocity that bombs fell in Mitcham, Kilburn, Hammersmith and Croydon. Fighter Command continued to attack the bombers as they returned to mainland Europe. That night, the public was informed by the Air Ministry that Fighter Command had shot down 183 German aircraft. In fact, the real figure was 56. However, the inflated figure was a huge boost to national morale. The damage to the Luftwaffe was more than just lost aircraft. Goering had told his men, before the first attack, that Fighter Command was down to its last 50 Spitfires. In fact, they faced over 250 fighters. While it is difficult to measure a drop in the opponent's morale, there can be little doubt that in the minds of the men at the sharp end of the Luftwaffe, the crews, Fighter Command was a very formidable opponent, as their own losses clearly indicated. Fighter Command lost 26 aircraft and 13 pilots were killed. The significance of September the 15th, 1940, was recognised by Prime Minister Winston Churchill when he stated that the day was the crux of the Battle of Britain. The battle was to continue into October, but without control of the skies, Operation Sea Lion simply could not take place. September the 15th ensured that the Luftwaffe was not going to gain such control. Pilot Officer Thomas Neal of 249 Squadron later said, "September the 15th was a very special day."
Thank you, Phil. And now a prayer will be said by one of our lady members, Moya Strachan.
We thank God for deliverance from world war. We thank you, most merciful Father, for your goodness to our nation in times past. Grant that we who meet to thank you today for the great mercy that we commemorate may praise you not only with our lips but with our lives, looking always to serve you, honoring you in our personal conduct and in our national life, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Reverend Rob Thomas will now introduce a hymn, God is Our Strength and Refuge.
Recollections such as those are what enable us to become increasingly aware of how much it is as individuals and as a nation we owe to the goodness of Almighty God. So to him we turn now with our praise as we sing our next hymn, God is Our Strength and Refuge.
God is our strength and refuge.
The next prayer is read by our Membership Secretary, Phil Lobb.
We pray for all our armed forces in service today. Heavenly Father, we pray for your protection, for our airmen, soldiers and sailors engaged in active service today in troubled parts of the world. We pray for them, remembering especially those with families and loved ones here in Trowbridge and West Wiltshire. May they act with the courage and, where possible, with compassion, so that at last a just and durable peace might be established everywhere in this, our damaged world. For Jesus' sake, Amen. And now Air Vice Marshal Martin Clark, our branch and area president, will now read Psalm 121.
Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Reverend Rob Thomas will now give an address.
On the 18th of June 1940, Winston Churchill, at that point having been Prime Minister for just a few weeks, stood up in the House of Commons and made what was to become one of his most famous speeches. And he ended like this. What General Vagon called the Battle of France is over. I expect that the Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be free and the life of the world may move forward into broad sunlit uplands. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duties and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say this was their finest hour. That's Churchill at his magnificent best, isn't it? Even today it stirs the heart. And this, of course, was a masterpiece of inspirational strategic leadership. He described the position from the perspective of the nation as a whole. He addressed the high-level challenge of the conduct of the entire war. Now, to have that perspective so powerfully articulated was vitally important, setting out for the British people the dimensions of the overall task. It was a call to commitment, a call to sacrifice. And it was the response of people's hearts and minds that was what eventually won the war. That was it, right there in the personal commitment and personal sacrifice of individual men and women, of sailors in their thousands, of soldiers in their tens and hundreds of thousands, of aircrew in their hundreds, of fighter pilots in their squadrons of tens and twenties. People like Geoffrey Wellham, at just about the same time as Churchill was addressing the House of Commons, a young 18-year-old Spitfire pilot by the name of Geoffrey Wellham was being posted with his squadron to Biggin Hill. And some of you, I know, will have read his autobiography, First Light. In it, he describes his state of mind at that critical moment. The squadron has just landed at Biggin Hill. The whole place has an air of total war and mortal combat. Broken Spitfires and Hurricanes, hangars in ruins, filled in bomb craters everywhere, and so much general bomb damage that one is left in no doubt whatsoever that all is total war. In spite of all this, the fighters still fly, and their station is still fully operational. He goes on to say, "This must be England at her most endangered and her most dangerous. Taking tremendous punishment, her back to the wall, but dishing it out too. We can only go forward, can't go back any further. England is being tested, and with her, my own personal testing time is about to begin. This is the moment for which I was trained, and the moment that has been on my mind largely since I joined the squadron. I am down on the order of battle for tomorrow morning at first light. Readiness at dawn. So be it. Soon I shall know what the others already know. I shall be either a man or a coward." Well, we know which he turned out to be, and many others like him. Where do people get their strength from in such a time? Churchill sometimes turned to the Bible. He himself recounted in the House of Commons that at the time of the great desert battles in Libya, he quoted the Gospel of St. Matthew in his advice to General Wavell. Now, whether Wavell found this counsel helpful is not recorded. But you know, Churchill was on the right track, because the Bible does have something important to say about this. Psalm 121, which we just heard, says, "I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." And here's the point. Ultimately, our destiny is not in our own hands, or in the hands of those who have great power, but in the hands of God. And the Christian insight is that that is good news, because we know what God is like. He is like Jesus Christ. And that means that he's on the side of the weak and the defenseless, the humble and the powerless, who turn to him in their need. It was the way of our nation in the dark days of 1940, a way that we do well to remember in our own troubling times. Because the same is true today. The security of our nation is in God's hands. We all remember 1982, the Falklands War. The Royal Navy battle group in that conflict was commanded, of course, by Admiral Sandy Woodward. And his book about it is called 100 Days. In it, he spells out what a very close-run thing it was. He wrote in his diary that at one point, things were so close that if the enemy had only breathed on us a touch more strongly, we'd have fallen over. Well, it was the same, wasn't it, in the Second World War? The miracle of Dunkirk, the Battle of Britain. The security of our nation does not depend upon our own strength or our own confidence, but rather upon the goodness of God. Over the years, he has been exceedingly gracious to us. We are the beneficiaries of a Christian heritage in this country, which has kept us as a nation conscious of God, with laws and customs that reflect his character and his justice. How much longer will this continue? Well, the picture here, in the psalmist's words, is of peace and security among nations who take God seriously. We heard these verses: "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore." Nations who take God seriously. These days in which we live are a turning point of destiny for our nation. And the outcome, just as in the war, just as in the Battle of Britain, depends not merely on identifying that final issue, nor merely upon articulating it persuasively, but rather, just as in the war, on the responses of individual people in their thousands, in their tens and hundreds of thousands, across the land, all committing themselves to honouring God. Not coerced into this, not compelled by political pressure or by force of opinion, not making a clamour about it, but responding with individual, personal conviction, conviction from the heart, conviction that to honour Jesus Christ as Lord is to honour God, and that any nation that desires security must recognise his sovereignty. And so the question for you and for me is whether we are willing to take our faith seriously in these days as individuals, and whether we're willing to commit ourselves to Christ's service in faithful prayer, in words and acts of obedient generosity that witness to his truth, whether we're willing to commit ourselves to Christ's church and to its mission of reaching the whole nation, indeed the whole world, with the love of Christ, the only source of all true and lasting peace. There's the issue, and that's the question. Who among us is willing? Amen.
And now a prayer by Barry Gladman, our branch secretary.
We pray for the peace of the world. God our Father, your will is that men and women should find peace with one another through knowing peace with you. Grant to all of us the knowledge of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, through whom you offer peace through forgiveness of what's past and peace through the assurance of your love and protection for the future. Grant such wisdom to leaders of governors in our own country and in others, that humility in knowing whose servants they truly are and to whom they must one day answer would lead them into the paths of justice and peace, to the suppression of evil in our world, and to the protection and support of all that is good. As your kingdom comes, may the whole earth be filled with the knowledge of your love. Through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, it seems very appropriate now, as we draw towards the end of our service, that we sing our final hymn, the Airman's Hymn, O Ruler of the Earth and Sky.
We now have a final few words from our branch chairman, Mike Sale.
Before the vicar concludes the service, it just remains for me to thank all those who contributed, not only my fellow members of the Royal Air Force Association and our president, but especially the technical team of St James's, without whom the recording of the service would not be possible. And finally, to those who are watching this service on Facebook or YouTube, please tell all your friends and relatives so they can watch it too at a later date. Thank you.
The Reverend Rob Thomas will now conclude this 80th Battle of Britain service with a blessing.
Well, we're really glad that you've been able to be with us for this very special service. And we conclude it now as I pray a prayer for you all. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you now and always. Amen.